fired up. It's made a great decision.
Great teammates, coaches, and other people who want to be Super Bowl champions. And we are. We're going to do it this year.
And we're going places because we want to go places.
Touchdown, Detroit Lions!
Before long, we're going to be the last one standing.
What is up, everybody? Welcome back to another video. In today's video, we are back with some of this All-22 look at the Detroit Lions. Today, taking a look at this Vikings game, specifically focused on the defensive side of the ball. I'm pretty sure we're going to do another one of these videos some point this week to take a look at the offensive side of the ball, because there was a lot of good, once again, on the offense, specifically with the passing game, where I thought this was the Lions' best passing game. And there was also some bad that I think should be pointed out. For example, Frank Ragnow, I think, really struggled in this game in comparison to our other offensive linemen, which is not something that usually see. He seemed to have some problems in this game, and you're hoping that he gets back consistent practice, and that's not the case. I believe in Frank Ragnow, but it was a rough game for him. So just to showcase some things like that. But in this video, I want to focus on the defensive side of the ball for the Lions. They had some issues in this game. It wasn't terrible. I'm not saying everything was bad. There was actually some good parts of the Lions defense, but there were some issues as well in this game. We gave up, of course, 28 points, which is too many, but there was some good, some bad. We're going to specifically take a look at the Lions run defense, some of those plays, some of the good, some of the bad, because a lot of it was unfortunately kind of bad. And then also Jeff Okuda and some Amani Oruwariye, who had like 5 penalties called against him. And just take a look at what seemingly kept happening to him and why, and look at the plays that he kept getting called for flags on. So things like that. But Jeff Okuda, the Lions plan to kind of slow down Justin Jefferson in this game, how they did it, how they only held him to 3 receptions, which last year, the 2 times we played them, we really struggled to slow down Justin Jefferson. So we're going to take a look at that as well. But this video, specifically taking a look at the defense, not everything on the defense because we'd be here forever, but some of these specifics. Now, before we get into some of this All-22 look, I first want to talk some numbers, because that's what we do around here. We talk some numbers. So I just want to throw some numbers at you, kind of put some things, make you think about it a little bit from this last game. Now, I would say the Lions' run defense was just not consistent. I think that's a big issue. Dalvin Cook in this game had 17 carries for 96 yards. Alexander Mattison had 7 carries for 28, which is only 4 yards a carry. That's not a lot. But the issue was specifically on first down. Now, I think a lot of times you can say that and be like, we got to be better on first down defensively. A lot of times you can say that, but I think in this game, the numbers clearly show that you weren't very good on first down in this game, and that led to problems really across the board. A limited pressure that we were able to get, it kept Minnesota extremely balanced, and it put us in a tough spot to force third down attempts. We had 9 third down attempts against us in this game. The good is they only converted 2 of those. But the bad is it was only 9, which is kind of low, considering that really the first 2 weeks we forced about 15.5 on average through Washington and Philadelphia, only 9 this week. But let's focus on that first down stat, because I think the numbers really kind of just say it here. On first down in this game, this is a number that, you know, I went through the stats here and came up with, so it may not be exactly right, but I believe it's pretty darn accurate, that on 33 attempts on first down, Minnesota had 191 yards altogether. That means they were averaging about 5.8 yards per play, 5.78 yards per play on first down in this game. Means that second down is pretty much open to do everything. You don't even have to pick up any yards on second down. You're still in a very third and manageable if you're giving up 6 yards per play on first down. And that was a big issue for the Lions. I think it limited the amount of pressure they were also able to get. And I think Minnesota had a good plan, specifically in their run game and how they kept things mixed up and how they got us into some trouble. At the same time, the Lions blitzed less than they had in the first 2 games. Their blitz rate dropped down from what it was at week 2. Now, it didn't drop down like a big amount, but it did drop down a little bit. So I don't think it was like vastly, like way less blitzing, but it was less, which was kind of anticipated because we've seen teams before this game play Minnesota that way, where they would kind of hit them with timely blitzes. But for the Lions, I think it limits your blitzing opportunities. Try to get that pressure, crank it up on third down. We did a couple times, but when you're having that many struggles on first down, it's kind of hard to do things like that because they're so balanced offensively. And now when you look at when the Lions actually had success on first down defensively, a majority of the time, not every time, but a majority of the time, the Lions were getting off the field. So here you go. I'll kind of run through it for you. Okay, now this is just the result on first down and what that led to for the rest of the drive. Okay, now we're only going to take I'll just explain. You'll see. Okay, so the first one we have is incomplete pass. That's a success for the defense. It's no yards gained. From that incomplete pass, it was a 3-and-out. I'm saying that not to say it was a 3-and-out that possession necessarily, but from that incomplete pass on first down, they went 3-and-out after that. They were off the field. All right, then they had a 0-yard run. After the 0-yard run, three and out off the field. They had a 3-yard play, a 3-yard run. The issue is the next play was an illegal contact, so that's an automatic first, so that one kind of throws it out the window. They're back on first down again. The next one was an incomplete pass. That one did not lead to an immediate 3-and-out. Another incomplete pass. Then we had a 2-yard run, which led to an immediate 3-yard out. We had another incomplete pass that led to an immediate 3-yard out. These are all on 3-and-out. These are all on first down. All right, you had a 2-yard run, a 1-yard run that led to an immediate 3-and-out, an incomplete pass that led to an immediate 3-and-out. So out of all of these attempts that I have, about 3 of those that were not immediately off the field, and then of course the flag. So majority of the time when you had a good play defensively on first down, the Lions had success. They were able to get off the field. They put more pressure on Kirk, who I wouldn't say was lighting us up. We actually did a lot of good in coverage. We were really creative schematically, and we gave them some fits. But the issue is, I think it limited our pressure, and on top of that, we struggled with this run game, and that kept them super balanced on the day. Our goal line defense was solid. You know, it was solid. We gave up one touchdown. We'll see it on this video where we completely just lost contain, and he just bounced it outside, which happened, and that was kind of like our Achilles heel in this game. The other time, we made him absolutely work for it. Our defense wasn't bad. It was not bad. We also forced a fumble, which was kind of forced by the offense. But first down defense seemed to kind of do us in this game for the whole. So let's take a look at some of the good, some of the bad from this game for the Lions defense. We'll kind of jump around to different plays, run defense, coverage as well, because I want to show some of those. And one issue that consistently showed up against the run for us was containing runs. And we know Minnesota is going to do all their cutback runs. It sets up off the zone runs that they do. But I think they also gave us a lot of things to think about. Okay, they did a lot of different alignments like this, where you'd have two wide receivers tight with a tight end. They also did different types of zone runs, a blocking scheme, and then the running back would do something different. He utilized his shoulders to kind of get our linebackers to bite in different spots. At the same time, they did their zone counters, their pull counters. They gave us a lot to look at in terms of the run game, and it gave us some fits specifically with containing runs. And a lot of times I don't even know like who's responsible for this or that, because they made it tough on us. So for the Lions, one thing that did consistently show up, however, was containing. Sometimes that was on our defensive backs not making the play when it bounced out that far. We'll take a look at this example, kind of jump around a little bit. This was a 13-yard run. He's going to cut back to the outside on his right side. So Lions did this kind of defensive technique in the front for a majority of the game, a 2-eye for Eric Banks, and usually they would have a 3-tech as well at the defensive tackle position. And we know Delvin Cook's reading that, you know, play side defensive tackle. So let's take a look at how this kind of plays out. Okay, boom. Now Lions changed it up. I will say Lions changed it up to try to give different looks to Minnesota in this game. You can see Banks pushing up on the guard. Michael Brocker's getting upfield, so they're going to leave kind of the A-gap open. Lions begin to fill with Alex and Board. However, then you're going to see the running back expects that too. He's going to cut and bounce outside. So now you have Chris Board, who's going to have to fill outside. So he's going to take those couple steps. Now he's got to fill back outside for us. But the real issue here comes in with Amani on this play, being the cornerback, kind of being on an island. They force this thing to get outside, but then you have to make the play. And again, with all these tight alignments, at times it would give us, make it tough for our defensive backs to get in on it. Lions started bringing blitzes with like Mike Hughes or Juju Hughes. Here you can see Juju Hughes, you know, gets blocked up by Adam Thielen, but that leaves Amani Oruwariye completely clean. So they slide the extra safety in the box. Amani has no one out here to worry about. They bounce it out to his side. Now he's one-on-one in the island, and unfortunately this time he gets to the edge. Take a look at some coverage here, okay? Like I said, we're going to bounce around a little bit. This is the first drive of the game for the Minnesota Vikings, and the Lions did play some man coverage in this game. They definitely did. Maybe even more than I anticipated. But with that being said, I want to take a look at Jeff Okuda on this play. He's at the top of the screen. The Lions ended up in this game shadowing Justin Jefferson with Jeff Okuda. Now from different alignments, they had a help him in different spots. They gave him like different help in different ways, but it's not like every play they put help on his side. That's not the case. There were a lot of one-on-ones with Justin Jefferson. We'll see some of that, but here they end up giving some help. So they like to play their two high safeties, but one thing what the Lions did, and it showed up on that last play where we gave the touchdown, is they would utilize the safety towards Jeff Okuda's side a lot of times to try to help him in coverage. So now a big reason I anticipate a lot of soft zone is because of the fact that Jefferson could line up in the slot in different positions. The Lions had their own trick up their sleeve saying, hey, we want to play man coverage, so we're going to put safety help to basically double team Jefferson. That way we can match up with him from any spot, and Okuda can carry. However, with that being said, later on in the game, you'll see they do put Will in the slot against him and make that change. They go two high safeties, but as you can see, this is Tracy Walker. He's still healthy at this point in the game. He's going to give some help to Jeff Okuda. He's going to kind of bracket him in inside. Now, we saw the double team. I may take a look at that one. I'm not sure if I wrote it down or not. We saw that one, but here's something similar. So you see he's already lined up on the outside of Justin Jefferson. Okay, I love seeing Jeff Okuda's feet. There's the hand. Look at the recovery. And then Tracy Walker is in the inside. So they kind of bracket him in. And he's really good movement skills, first off. Jeff Okuda looks really good in terms of the way that he's moving. This isn't perfect, but the way that he's opening his hips, he just looks healthy, which is great. There was one rep, hopefully I have it in here, off the line. It was just like, whoa, look at that dude's feet. But the recovery ability against a shifty receiver like Justin Jefferson, but you can see how the Lions try to utilize some help. Also, you do see Imani at the bottom here. Now, not really focusing on this play too much, but this showed up a lot, okay? When he was on the outside, he'd get opened up. Now he's on the outside hip of the receiver, and a lot of times when it came to the top of the route, he would end up grabbing like this, getting physical with the receiver. He looked like maybe he was lacking some control. Not sure why exactly. He could have still been injured. We'll take a look at some more clips of that, but that is something that did show up. So I just wanted to kind of point that out there now so you can look for it as we end up going through this. This one, another one of those cutback runs. This was a 9-yard run, and I said the Lions will give different looks as we get through going through this game. This is early in the game, but this is one of those cutbacks, and again, it utilized that motion, kind of moving our linebackers a little bit. It was also really important, these tight receiver alignments blocking guys like Mike Hughes like this, where they were kind of on the outside, they could potentially contain this run. The receiver is getting up and making blocks, and the Lions had to adjust and be prepared for that as well. Okay, but look at this play. One thing is, you see a guy like Lee McNeil, it didn't seem like he was filling two gaps as we talked about last week as often this game. He had a couple good reps in here, but it wasn't the same in terms of like sometimes he was taking up two lanes, really helping out the linebackers. That wasn't always the case. Actually, sometimes our D-line were getting pushed back to the linebackers and they weren't able to really even see where the ball is at. So here, again, the Lions come out in the same alignment as we just took a look at with the 2-eye and the 3 technique. Let's take a look. You could see the 3 technique on the strong side of the formation, the 2-eye on the weak side of the formation. They did a lot of weak side run. They're also going to have basically a lead blocker out there. Now you can see the Lions are filling these lanes. Okay, also the running back shoulders are now squared to the line of scrimmage, so he has the opportunity to cut back. But the Lions are filling these lanes. Aleem's not taking up two gaps, so the Lions are playing really aggressive at this point downhill. Let's take a look. All right, Aleem McNeil doesn't get into the A. He's in the B gap. Okay, now you have Alex who's going to try to fill in the A. And you have Isaiah Bugs who's trying to get into potentially the B gap on this play. All right, so it maybe opens up a little bit more of a crease, but now it emphasizes Alex Anzalone's got to go here and fill, and that leaves a wide open cutback lane for Delvin Cook. So the Lions had to find ways to kind of adjust to this. They were asking their defensive ends to crash down, crash inside these tight ends, not sit out here and, you know, contain. They were asking them to crash inside, and I think part of that may have stemmed from them playing those tight receivers alignments, that they were doing that. So they asked Aiden Hutchinson to crash down inside. Their tight end was blocking really well. He wasn't allowing us to just get like crazy penetration into the backfield, or just, you know, they gave us a couple of opportunities to be free off the end, but when they tried to block, they did slow down our guys a little bit. But you can see the cutback lane forming. No one's able to kind of fold over and get back into this play, and now Mike Hughes is being picked up by their receiver, so there's no one here when they go and cut back. There's no one on this play, and again, you see here, which is interesting, there's no receiver also on this field. They have the tight end receiver, right? That obviously, you know, you got those run pass fits that a guy like Imani has to be aware of. But the receiver left that side of the field. So Mike Hughes, being patient, kind of holding his ground, it allows the receiver to get up on him and block him. And now there's this huge lane that's been created, and no one is filling into that to contain off the backside when they cut back as they did. The Lions do this in the second half as well. Here's one of the little things that they kind of threw in there. And of course, it's just a tough spot because of the position that they're putting our guys in. It looks like Aaron Glenn's going to dive a blitz. It's sometimes we talk about, right? You blitz to stop the run, help out there, especially with all these cutbacks that they were hitting. So in this play, the Lions get aggressive. So they basically slant their defensive lineman inside. So you're going to slant to the A. And that opens up the lane for Mike Hughes to basically blitz off the corner. So let's take a look. You can see they're going to slant inside. Take another look at this, but I thought I'd give you another angle. Watch Hutchinson. He plays this completely different than the last play. This time he's really crashing down and squeezing off the offensive line, which is going to take that tight end's attention. But what that does is he's closing up that gap really from the outside in. So it allows Alex Anzalone to not have to fill. He can help work downhill. So you can see how it moves every gap over versus the last play, how he's kind of focused on the tight end and filling his lane. This play, he's crashing that lane from the outside in through the offensive lineman, opening up Alex Anzalone to step down. It's just well done. Now Mike Hughes is going to blitz off the corner, get inside of number 17 here, so it takes away some of that cutback lane initially, and then opens up Alex Anzalone to be a little bit more clean, get downhill, and end up making the tackle and limit this to a 2-yard gain. Did this with their offensive line scheme, which made it sort of difficult for our linebackers because, you know, they would show one thing and the running back would do something completely different. They did that a lot in this game. Okay, so here you get that zone step from Delvin Cook, but obviously the offensive line is flowing this way to a zone run this way, but now the play side is the right side of the offensive line, which changes things up. But the Lions are slanting, they're diving to that side of the field. And because of that, you can see Mike Hughes blitzing in, and Alex Anzalone is able to get downhill as it stalled a little bit because Mike Hughes is there, and they limit it to a 2-yard gain. So here Deshaun Elliott communicates with Juju Hughes. As you can see, he comes down into the box. The Lions had to start doing this, I think, a little bit. So Elliott comes down the box. You have the inline tight end. Here comes the fast motion left. So Juju Hughes is going to pop back up. But with that fast motion, now the linebackers have to be aware and be able to pick that up. Okay, so now this is one of those times where we get the free rusher. The Lions are asking their edge guys to basically crash down on these plays. And here when you have a free rusher, he's basically just going right into the hip of Dalvin Cook on this play. There's nothing for, you know, Charles Harris to worry about here. But then I think it's also good on the fly. They communicate this well. They take on the fast motion. Deshaun Elliott just goes right by the tight end. No chance on that play. And you have a free Charles Harris who's in the backfield to make a play on this run. Here's that double team play that we just talked about. Let's show the double team play where the Lions got off the field. And they show this one on the replay. So I think some people assume that they double teamed every single play, which again was not the case. They did it. They found ways to help out Okuda. But it was interesting because again, they're shadowing. Usually Okuda is not going to be in the slot here. He's usually not going to be in that situation in a bunch here on Justin Jefferson. I would say they're in the slot. Usually he's not going to be in that position on the inside, but he is here. So as you can see, basically what they're going to utilize is safety help on this play. So obviously they have to have good depth so that they're not rubbing into each other, which ended up happening at one point. Mike Hughes ran into, I think, their offensive player, and they had a free route, and they ended up missing the pass. But anyways, they get good depth between each other here to make sure that they can pass this off. But Okuda's going to get on the outside of Justin Jefferson, and then Deshaun Elliott can bracket this thing in from the inside. Obviously, Kirk Cousins sees that pre-snap. He's like, that's where I want to go with it. But good job by the Lions. They take that away. Kind of playing this in a little bit of a robber role, but then here he goes, right? Plays the inside leverage. And then give credit to everybody else, right? Mike Hughes covering up this drag out where he tries to come back late, and he's all over that. The tight end ends up falling down, I think, on this play. And also Amani at the bottom here on Thielen. It wasn't a great day, but it wasn't all bad for Amani. Here is pretty good coverage. Pretty good coverage throughout this play. Kind of just plasters that thing up. It's an underneath route. Clearly the idea was, let's get Justin Jefferson on this corner route one-on-one with Okuda. That's going to be tough for him to cover because you show inside. But because we're bracketing it, now Okuda can easily just sit on the outside of this corner route and take that away. Kirk, by the time he tries to come back, Amani's all over it. The drag route is taken away, and then you get pressure and you throw it away. So when we talk about, when I say like, hey, Lions getting a lot of pressure, but credit their secondary, because it's not like to say, well, we got all these shutdown corners, but the way the Lions creatively are throwing things at the defense that they have to kind of look out for, it allows them to get some pressure. Look how long he's holding on to this football. I mean, he went through three guys before you finally get pressure, and Alex sneaks through. We didn't win enough one-on-one on the defensive line, but creativity there, you get off the field. The way that Isaiah Bugs, we'll show it here, the way that Isaiah Bugs was playing this 2-eye, okay, he was playing this thing, man, he was playing it technically, like, so well, okay, watch, first off, let's just focus on Isaiah Bugs and his hand technique over here, okay, getting his right hand inside the chest of the offensive lineman, the left hand on the outside shoulder, and then he just throws him off and absolutely fills this lane, and Dalvin Cook's like, oh, snap, I gotta cut this outside. He did this multiple times in that game, so when they get that one-on-one with the offensive lineman, and you need him to shed, he played that so darn well. Now, on the opposite side, obviously, you got to leave McNeil in the 3 on this play. He's going to get up on the guard here. But, man, I love how he's playing that. Hutchinson also here. Amani, though, as we said before, right, he's got the tight end on his side. Hutchinson, however, is going to focus on taking that tight end off the line of scrimmage. So watch this. It's interesting. Watch this. Hutchinson gets on the tight end off the line of scrimmage. So now Amani is tighter to the line, not having any receivers on his side, maybe a little bit of an adjustment. He's much tighter as that force player, and they limit this to just a few yard gain. So they kind of change it up. Now Hutchinson's going to kind of get double teamed. Aleem McNeil does a pretty nice job on this play, basically kind of just shaking around the offensive lineman and not letting penetration or movement back to the linebackers. Let's take a look at that. Boom. He gets up on the guard quickly, and then he gets himself in a good spot, turns his body, does not allow that double team to move him. And now, of course, when your defensive line's playing like that, your linebackers can start working up on the line of scrimmage. He's looking for the cutback lane. Hush is on the tight end. Amani's free, and they limit this to like a 3-yard gain. So that was actually a good play by the defensive line. It's one of those plays where to me it looks like Hutchinson, because it's not really help. There's going to be a massive gap that's going to be created here. And again, D linemen, you know, when they get pushed back to the second level, it makes it very difficult. So you have a similar alignment, same alignment that we've been seeing, similar to the play earlier, right? You got a tight, you know, receiver, the jet motion across. All right, let's take a look at this play. So here, they're going to be running, like, it looks like an outside zone. The running back shoulders are not square to the line, right? They're kind of in that angle. So our linebackers are going to begin to crash and fill their lanes. What happens, obviously, you can see their linebackers are kind of moved back on this play. And when your defensive line is not really filling those lanes immediately, you can't really fold back over. Let's take a look at this play one more time. Let's just kind of rewind this. All right, so watch this. Aleem McNeil, right? They're jumping off the line. I think this is very subtle, but very well done by the offensive line, getting his hands early on Aleem. And with that, it kind of slows it down for Aleem to really get upfield, right? So now he can't get upfield, disrupt this play, and now the offensive lineman puts Aleem McNeil back on the left tackle, so now he's not getting any penetration. The interior offensive lineman gets a chance to work up cleanly to Alex Anzalone, so that makes it tough for him, but then it's this backside with Aiden Hutchinson. This one to me looks like it's on Hutchinson. The Lions really didn't have a lot of answers on this backside on this play aside from that. Again, everybody's kind of doing the same thing. They're all kind of crashing inside. Hutchinson crashing on this tight end, though, it's like his hands got locked up or something. You can see here, I mean, yeah, he's like hugging him basically, but he's unable to get off. Probably should have been a hold. Unable to get off, and he ends up getting like a yard out of the arm reach of Hutchinson. For some reason, it just froze. I don't know what just happened. Oh, I think this was kind of creative because they kept giving us one thing, and our linebackers are all crashing and playing aggressive. So I think this is just a great play. They're going to do a counter pull on here. Let's take a look at it. Okay, so obviously you see the guard's going to pull out, so it's going to become a counter on this play. So everybody's flowing this way, and now you got to try to take care of this counter run, which is an issue because they kind of see how we're playing this, right? Hutchinson, he's playing inside of the tight end, not on the outside. So everybody's playing like that. I think you're putting stress on your secondary players who they're trying to get to bounce out to. And on this play, let's actually take a look from the other angle first, because even Dan Campbell's touchdown, we're putting a lot of stress on our secondary players. Well, when you get something like this, where you have Adam Thielen, who's not in a tight alignment, more in a slot alignment, but he's going to run, you know, basically like a, I mean, he's not even running a real route here, but Imani's going to be carried by it. Then our safety, he's going to actually go up and block our safety. So he's taking two of our secondary players out of the play at the same time. We have no contain on this play. That happened too often. I'm sure our guys will be more prepared for that going forward, but that happened way too often, where like this guy should not be able to take out two of our defenders, and that's pretty much what he did here. While at the same time, take a look at this kind of in slow, okay? Brocker's attacking upfield. Eric Banks going to play through a guard who's not there because he pulled out, so he's not really playing through anybody. But as we saw earlier, your linebacker has to fill the A-gap. Someone's got to fill the A-gap, so now you're putting that responsibility on Malcolm to fill the A-gap based on how we've been playing. Well, he's filling the A-gap, but there's no running back there. So as he fills this, there's no one for him to actually, you know, worry about on this play, and Alex Anzalone has to try to fold all the way around to this pulling offensive lineman, which he can key as soon as it snaps. He sees him running out there. You can see it right here, but obviously there's no one out there to stop the run, right? And the offensive line's playing this thing a little bit different. You can see they're kind of slow off the line, so maybe with more time, Malcolm may be able to pick up on that a little bit. But here, as you can see, right, they take advantage of kind of what we're doing. They get to the corner, and we have no edge contain at all, and they pick up another big run. And I thought the Lions had a really nice goal line stand. It's unfortunate they got the flag that they did, but I don't think it was like, well, Lions, I mean, it's tough in goal line because majority of the time you're playing goal line man. So then it comes down to the offense pretty much knows that. Can you pass off these routes in these situations, and can you communicate well and be fast to do it and really win your one-on-ones? And I thought, credit to the Lions, I thought a lot of times in these goal line pass situations they did that. The touchdown they ended up getting from the 1 yard line after the PI was a breakdown without communication. We'll take a look at that play happening, but let's take a look at this first one here. All right, we'll see Imani at the top of the screen. He's on Adam Thielen. He gives up the inside. And again, you see how physical he's getting throughout these routes. I don't know why he's doing that. He looks uncomfortable. I think some of it does stem off the release. We'll take a look at it again. He doesn't really have help on this play. Could have been the back issue, not feeling that comfortable and being able to kind of control himself. Again, I don't think he's the most sticky and, you know, sticky kind of man coverage corner. I didn't think that coming into the year. But it just looked a little off for Okuda.
Now, I'll make this point later in the video, but last year, Jerry Jacobs played a very physical style against Thielen. The difference is he didn't get called for any flags, but Jerry Jacobs is a different body type. He is a small, stout, press type of cornerback that played a lot of outside leverage and played that against Thielen basically all game and pretty much shut him down. I don't know if Imani has the exact same body type for that, and he looked just a little bit uncomfortable at times in this game.
But you can see off the release, now he's kind of in a trail position, but even when the pacing of his route, they would kind of slow down and work into him, then he didn't really have that great control. He was almost like trying to catch up, so he starts leaning on the receiver, grabbing him, holding him, and it came back to bite him later. Even here, he's being super physical, and he kind of, I don't like, to me, they called some stuff, but the ref don't call this. I'm just saying. Either way, let's take a look at the bottom here on Jeff Okuda here, because Okuda had a good day. He's playing some outside leverage, but let's take a look at the difference. That's what I would look at the difference, man. Okuda We saw this against San Fran, I think, last year in the small reps that he played. But the way he can kind of play underneath routes, play off of his help, which we've already seen. He does a great job playing with help. But play, like, underneath the route. Route gets over top, not panicking, being very technically sound, not grabbing. Even there was a play in this game where he was kind of like this, like, I'm not touching him. Let's take a look. Okay, so he's on the outside here. The inside release. Look at him. He's going to be underneath this route. He's going to be physical, but then he's going to let go. And then he's just going to kind of sit underneath this route. Like, where's the receiver going to go? I mean, where's he going to go? I'm going to sit underneath this route, understanding the situation, and he basically just plasters this route completely, takes it away. Then you also have Juju Hughes, who probably should have made the play here, who I thought had a good game aside from maybe the last play. Maybe? Take a look at this. Juju Hughes nearly had an interception. It's good coverage across the board. The slot's taken care of by Deshaun Elliott, which is awesome. He's been huge here in coverage for us. Malcolm's going to drop, but look at this. Juju, he basically just threw it right at Juju. I mean, if it was a better throw, he probably picks that off. Regardless, though, good coverage across the board from the line. Let's jump back a little bit because I skipped one. I don't want to spend too much time on this one, but I thought I would at least point it out. This is the play. Just give some love to Malcolm on this one. This is good. He ended up taking CJ Ham out of the backfield here, not crashing and running by him. Discipline gets on it, limits that to a 3-yard gain. So I think I might as well at least point that out. I think it's a good job by the line. It's on the fly to do this. So Mike Hughes and Jeff are going to pass this off. So let's take a look here, right? So you can see the inside release. Watch how seamless they pass this off. This is big time. I mean, that's well done. That's what they try to do in the red zones. They try to get you to, you know, mess up, make mistakes. It's a small, condensed area of the field. They know you're probably playing man coverage, so they're trying to get you to miscommunicate and get a wide open touchdown like they did the very next play. But here, that's not the case, okay? Okuda seamlessly passes this off with the inside release. Mike Hughes picks that up. Okuda, again, look at him play underneath this. I love how he doesn't panic, man. He kind of just sits underneath behind the receiver, and then just he's got the footwork and the hips to kind of match him out of this break. Look at this. Boom, and I'm on it. Like, it's awesome. It is awesome for Jeff to see him do stuff like that. Now just getting to see him play more. But then Mike passes this off well. You got a Monty on the top of the screen here. He's going to be covering, looks like just a drag here. And he's also got some safety up, so he's kind of playing into that. But Mike is going to get called for PI on this. Again, I'm still not in agreement at all. I can kind of see how it came out because it's like, well, I see he put his arm there. Shouldn't I have been a PI, in my opinion. But I just like the way that they communicated it. However, I didn't like the way that they communicated it this. Let's take a look. Okay, so you can see the issue to me is not that these two had an issue, right? They already communicate pre-snap, hey, we're probably going to pass this off, right? We're going to switch this. The issue is you get a fast motion across the field with Jeff Okuda. They know you're in man coverage that these two are unable to communicate pre-snap. So this is something on the fly that one just has to do it and the other one has to know what's happening. And in this case, Jeff Okuda and Amani, we're not on the same page because Amani basically just said, hey, look, take that, Okuda. Saying, look, hey, I'm taking that fast motion. You take my guy. Okuda's not paying any attention to that. He's just trying to catch up to his guy across the field. And you can see they both cover the same dude, and it's a wide-open touchdown. So that one is just, you know, hey, they took advantage. But the PI basically got them to that play. So now on this play, the Lions, they do something a little different. You're going with a pretty heavy personnel set here. You see, it looks like they got two tight ends. I think, yeah, Irv Smith. So you got two tight ends on this play. You're going 12. But let's take a look at this one. The Lions is probably their best run defensive rep, honestly, in the game. And I think that's because they matched up well with it, and there wasn't a lot that the Lions were going to be confused by, maybe, with this play, and they're going to run a split zone. And because they run a split zone, Hutchinson quickly, which I love, reacts to it. Okay, so he already knows he's playing, you know, the tackle on this play. Again, they have Chris Board. So Hutchinson's going to get outside the tackle. He makes a phenomenal play here, and they shut this down. Same interior defensive line technique, basically. See Banks trying to do the, you know, he's trying to do the hand and then the, but at the same time, it doesn't really work because I don't think his left hand placement was right. Regardless, let's take a look at Aiden Hutchinson on this play. Let's take a look at him against the offensive tackle, which is on the play side, which is great. So let's take a look at this. They ran a lot to the weak side. Here we go. Watch this. All right. Gets outside because the split zone, he's got a little more room to work. So he's able to attack, gets his hands on him, and ooh, there's the shed. Like, this is a fantastic play by Hutchinson, really. Like, that is an awesome play by Aiden Hutchinson on that play. But at the same time, let's watch the running back, okay? Let's watch how he does this, all right? So there you go. You can see he doesn't really change anything up. His shoulders are not, you know, it's not like a, he doesn't have like, you know, he's not parallel with the sideline. But it's like the 45-degree angle shoulders. So Hutch has to jump outside and get on this. He sheds, forces this thing back inside. It's weird that he didn't make that tackle, but that's because he was like in the process of shedding the block. But he got out to where he was. And again, we don't put a lot of these responsibilities, specifically in this game, on our edge rushers to contain. It was more so the guys outside of that. I think secondary players saw a lot. So sometimes linebackers, things like that.
To me, that was by plan. The Minnesota Vikings came in understanding they didn't want the Detroit Lions edge rushers to set the edge, Charles and Hutch. They were going to put pressure on our secondary or linebackers to be able to set the edge by playing tight alignments with receivers slash tight ends. So when they did it and the defensive end in this case can set the edge, you could see our defensive end can make the play.
But when you do, Hutchinson did a fantastic job here. Also, I think Brockers did a really nice job the way that he got upfield, got some penetration. I think that was big time as well. All right, let's take a look at it. And then you're going to have a free defender again on Charles Harris, who's just going to crash through. So let's take a look. Let's take a look at Brockers. You see him get upfield here. They're trying to set up what's like a double team, but he gets upfield really fast. All right, and then I guess Charles Harris wasn't clean, the tight end, but he was inside the tight end. Okay, he was inside the tight end in this case, which they usually are. He crashes inside. He's going to be there to basically clean this thing up after Hutchinson makes the initial effort play, and it's -2 yard run. All right, let's take a look at both Amani and Okuda here. I think Amani's going to get called for a penalty and maybe give up the reception as well in this play. So anyway, let's take a look though. You get the outside release, so he's going to be opened up on the outside. And then again, this seemed to give him problems. And actually, this does bring him back to last year because I thought he got better at this as year went on, but there were times where you'd see him kind of overplay these routes and get on top, and then they kind of like break back outside and he'd be in a bad spot. So here it looks like he's trying to get physical with him, but as the wide receiver kind of fades towards the outside, then breaks back in, as they fade, he looks just out of control a little bit, like he's running into the receiver. I'm not sure why. Maybe he's anticipating that as soon as he starts to fade, he's gonna break back in. He's like, let me get on that early. It's tough to cover, I get it. I think from the outside perspective, this is difficult, because as soon as you start to feel that, you're probably thinking they're cutting inside, I gotta get under, be able to undercut that. But then when it doesn't immediately happen, you're running right into the receiver.
And in this case, Adam Thielen's able to create so much separation with Amani that he's kind of squeezing himself back into the play. He's not in his hip from the release like maybe Jeff was, or we saw Jerry last season at times against Thielen.
And then he's going to break off, and now there's that separation that's created, and I think that one actually got him for a flag as well. This play action is difficult because the Lions are seeing this look, and they're having some problems against it already defensively, so now you get the play action off it, and this is where play action is tough, right? You get the split zone, so what did we see last time from Hutch? He's going to try to jump outside this tackle and set the edge. That's kind of what he's trying to do here, but it's difficult to get pressure when you do that. Also, they leave in an extra blocker, which to me, let's take a look at this one again. Okay, you got an extra blocker here on Charles Harris. Let's take a look. Charles Harris, okay, boom. Then they come around with the second blocker, makes the, you know, shugs the first guy off. Then the second blocker, he's running around anyways. That's the split zone blocker, and he's unable to win very quickly. And then Jeff Okuda on the top here. It's just a vertical route, so not too much to take a look at, but it is good coverage again. You can see him open up, be physical with the receiver, but he's not getting called for the flag. And I just think what's sticking out to me is the way that he's breaking down and opening back up. Like, that's huge, man, to be running. And I don't know if he's running full speed, but he's moving here. And to be able to slam on the brakes with the receiver, yeah, he uses his hands a little bit, but to be able to do that is not easy. And I think Okuda looks like he's gotten way better in that department versus what I've seen from Okuda in the past. That seemed to be something that could give him issues at top of routes, at catch point as well. That looks good. This is one where Okuda was not great. And we talk about how much they're putting on, I think, the secondary players in this game. They got a lot of things to look at. But you can see it already. You can see it already. This is a touchdown that basically I think Jeff Okuda gives up on this play. Let's take a look. He does not contain it at all. Reason being is that he peeks for 1 second. He's like, hey, what's going on over here? And he dives inside. So fast motion again could have been the result of this. Also, you have Adam Thielen. So maybe you're anticipating like, hey, maybe there's a route coming this way. Could something be coming? There's the mesh point. I'm not sure why. For whatever reason, though, he peeks inside on this play. And as soon as he does that, as soon as he peeks inside, he loses his edge contain, and Dalvin Cook is walking into the end zone. I don't know why he does that, but he does on this play, and he gives up a touchdown. It's unfortunate, but again, I think that's where our corners, you know, they tackle, but that had to be better. I love how Hutchinson absolutely drove and blew this tight end into the backfield. I mean, he literally hit the running back with the tight end. That's not easy. He hit the running back with the tight end on this play, but you don't see it because we didn't contain on the outside. So this just looked at his dang, we gave up a touchdown. But it's just that 1 second, Charles trying to set the edge here and get outside. He's kind of locked up a little bit. So with that, you see Okuda peeking inside, gives up a touchdown. Can't do it, man. Gotta be disciplined against this team. They do all these cutback runs. You gotta be disciplined. You see how lines are kind of filling gaps on this play. And again, when the D-line does well, linebackers can start to work downhill. They can also kind of fold outside a little bit easier. There's an example in this where Alex Anzalone gets basically an offensive lineman at his grill 7 yards back. And he's like, dude, what am I supposed to do? All right, but take a look at this one. Again, we took a look at safety comes in the box and he's gonna blitz off the edge. They start to do things like this. 8-man box for the Lions. Hutchinson in the 6 is gonna be working the inside of the tight end. So board's gonna get on the edge here. All right. right, and they're going to start to fill their lanes. But it's Juju Hughes who rushes off the backside, which has been killing us in this game. You want to be aggressive upfield? Well, you got to contain the backside. And in this case, Juju Hughes makes a good tackle, and he's been doing this. They crash down with their defensive line. You can see through the offensive line, he's crashing down. But I also think part of that ends up taking CJ Ham and drawing attention to CJ Ham here, who is the lead backer, and you have to be worried about that as well. So you have this lead blocker, but I think big time, look at the play side, your defensive lineman is not getting killed. All right, so initially you're seeing that. Then you also have Isaiah Bugs, who's kind of filling in behind that, right? So Ali McNeil is not allowing the offensive line to get to the second level on him immediately. Let's take a look. Boom, from that three. All right, you can see he's not allowing that immediately. Take a look at, you see that jump off the line of scrimmage from Bugs, filling his lane, getting upfield. Now, all of a sudden, it draws some attention. All right, so now CJ Ham's looking for a cutback. At the same time, Charles Harris crashing down the line of scrimmage. All right, he's going to end up picking up CJ Ham, but there's nowhere for Delvin Cook to go, and Hughes can come in and finish that play. When the defensive line wins, that's big time, and then they just have to figure out how to contain, and that was a good example. Let's go back a little bit. This is before the half. Let's take a look at a little bit more coverage here. This one's before the half. That last run play was after the half. I know we're bouncing around a lot here. I just got some plays that I wanted to show. Here's another example of just something similar happening to Imani on this play. Let's take a look. Man coverage and end up scoring, which is great. But let's take a look here. Imani on the bottom. You can see that he's going to release kind of through the midline of the cornerback here. Now he opens him up. I don't think Okuda's in a bad spot in this spot, but then he starts to kind of fade back into him, and Imani gets all up on him. He starts to grab him, and here's the flag again. But then he's kind of overcommitting, so now he finds himself behind, and all of a sudden when he goes to break back outside, now he's on the inside. He's just grabbing at this point. It just looked like he wasn't under very good control at the top of the route. That seemed to be the issue with Imani in this game, which could have been an injury thing. I'm not sure, but it definitely looked like he was just a little bit out of control at the top of the route. Whatever reason, I'm not sure why. He really is trying to protect the outside. I get that. But for some reason, he's just finding himself grabbing. Meanwhile, Okuda, again, we like how he utilizes his help. He's got two deep safeties on this play. So watch Okuda. He's going to be playing on the inside. All right. So he's going to allow that outside release. But then there's the jam. Okay. I like this. And then, man, you see how controlled he's playing with the safety help? He's doing a really good job of that. So I think there's two different scenarios going on here. Okuda's got a safety right over top to help him. These guys are a little bit more on an island. But it still needs to be. To me, it's got to be better, right? Still got to be better from Imani and guys like that. But Okuda on this play, I think it's good. He's physical. And then at the same time, he doesn't get physical at the top. He just kind of sits underneath this route, brackets it in with the top safety. But Imani is called for the flag. We got three deep on this play. The middle safety, Will, is going to start to slide down. So I guess that's just a look at a way the Lions try to utilize him as a third safety. That's interesting. But Okuda, look at the feet. Oh, my goodness. And there were better reps, I think, than this one. But just look at his feet off the line of scrimmage. I always thought he was so good at the line of scrimmage. I really did. When he was healthy, I thought he was great at the line. Sometimes he would just get beat when getting over top, but I think he's gotten way better at that. However, at this point, he could be aggressive, I think, because he usually had safety help over top. So in this point, you see his feet. There's the contact with the inside hand, and then he's able to get connection on the outside. And he just plays right underneath that, just kind of mirrors the receiver throughout the rest of the play. But extreme example of what I mean by that, Okuda being able to kind of play underneath the route. Adam Thielen's going to go down and fall down on this play, trying to like block inside. But you can see how he's able to kind of just let it run by. He knows he's got one safety over top, so he can just play underneath the route. And at this point, also, you know, good job by Malcolm Rodriguez in coverage. But also shows some pressure, shows some love to Ali McNeil, man. We've been seeing it, like he can get pressure. And here he is, boom, immediate. Like, you see that overhand swim move on the outside shoulder of the offensive lineman? That is nasty, right? He is playing really well, and he was even utilizing some third down packages to get pressure, and he has been getting pressure. So we'll take a look from this angle because, man, I just love to see Aleem playing. Like, he's not getting enough credit. He really isn't, man. To be doing both, he's not getting enough credit. Look at that. Bam! Oh, my goodness. I see you, Aleem. Like, that's how it's... That's really well done from Aleem. He's the guy that's getting the pressure and forcing out the pocket, right? Now, of course, they put a tight end on Hutchinson's side, so now he's got that to deal with, and it's, yeah.
But this is part of the reason it's tough for the Lions to get some pressure. Of course, on the left tackle, I want to see Charles win more of these, and I thought he was going to be very important in this game, but they can quick set things like that. Hutch basically has three guys accounting for him between the tight end, Adam Thielen, and an offensive tackle. But then on top of that, you're also having to play your run lanes the majority of the time. So you're not playing for the pass. You're not just pinning your ears back. You're jumping into your lane. Then when it turns into play action, you react off of that.
I mean, yeah. But anyways, Aleem gets pressure. This one looks like a zone blocking play. To me, this is like a duo. dual blocking scheme. It can look like zone. It definitely can, but you can see how that looks, how it is a duo on this play with the double team they put on Aleem McNeil. So it's just creative how they did this, and they're also moving to the tight end side. So it's going to be a duo block here with the two tight receiver sets, and now the Lions got to worry about trying to contain again. So they're giving us a lot of looks. So here's the duo block on Aleem. He's in the B gap, taking sign of that power step a lot of times, but in this case, now they duo block him, so now it's double teamed. They're not worried about getting up to the second level on this play. Here you have sort of that zone blocking. You have your kind of kickout block on the edge here to kind of protect, and now you can see Alex Anzalone. Haven't seen this a ton, but the D-line's getting pushed back to Alex Anzalone, and he's unable to fold back over. Charles is playing inside the tight end, and they really don't have a guy here on the outside to contain this run. So this is schematically something the Lions got to find a way to be better with, I believe, is like, okay, how do we contain, especially for next time around against this team, how do we do that, right? Is it being more aggressive with like a guy like Mike Hughes as Amani? I don't know, but that's just an issue. And we're not getting moving with their D-line. They're getting pushed into the linebackers. That's a problem. Here, he's going to be playing on the A-gap. It looks like on this play, Aleem McNeil, let's take a look. He is going to be in the... Yes, he's going to be in this three tech. So he's going to be trying to get, you know, upfield in this B gap, but he's going to be getting pushed by this, you know, other offensive lineman. So now this center is free to kind of go free, and just leads to about a 5 yard run with kind of the push they get in the interior on that one. This is actually maybe another good one from the Lions. It's a negative 2 yard run that they end up holding this to. Imani's going to make the tackle for loss. Good play by Imani this time. Similar thing, right? The receiver's going to kind of just set inside, try to take both of our defenders like they did earlier, and they end up getting to the edge. This one's a little bit different though. So they're going to go with this counter pull on this play. And I think a big part is actually what Hutchinson does on this run. So let's take a look. Same thing as we've seen pretty much all game. You got him jumping up here on the offensive guard. So Malcolm's got to fill the A gap. But then here comes the pulling offensive lineman. This got us into trouble earlier. So now you're going to have Alex Anzalone try to fold back out here. But I think a huge part of this one is Aiden Hutchinson and what he does to this pulling offensive lineman coming his way. Let's take a look. Okay, he's on the outside of the tight end, not on the inside, as we saw a little bit earlier in this game. And the receiver's in a wider alignment, so he's on the outside of the tight end.
Again, I can't credit Kevin O'Connell in this offensive scheme. I think they tried to take out our edge rushers from being the contained players. So here, as you can see, because the receiver's in a wider alignment, he could play outside of the tight end. When they're in these tight alignments, it's difficult for him to do that. The last time they did a split zone away from him, so he's able to set the edge against the tackle. This time they pull a lineman towards his direction. Let's take a look.
Tight end really doesn't get a block on him. He's working to cut off another one of these linebackers and whoever's folding around, which Malcolm Rodriguez crashed zone.
And I want to show this real quick. This is really subtle, but using the tight end here to initially engage with Hutch and then drop off is really trying to not allow him to take this pulling offensive lineman, but Hutch reacts and gets off and does take away the pulling offensive lineman. Again, they're either getting outside of our edge rushers or they're using tight ends, which is forcing us to utilize a different contained player. They're doing a great job of really scheming away from specifically an Aiden Hutchinson in this game. They're trying to not allow him to pick up this pulling offensive lineman by engaging with him originally, then using the tight end to cut off the linebacker so that they can bounce this outside.
So I guess Alex Anzalone whenever he comes around. But I think it's big here how Aiden Hutchinson ends up picking up this pulling offensive lineman. See, boom. He gets that contact with the pulling offensive lineman. His shoulder turns the offensive lineman. Now there's no one for the running back to kind of follow behind, right? That closes that off. Now there's no one for him to follow behind. So let's take one more look. We're going to see the pulling offensive lineman come around. He gets connection right there. Okay, so he takes him out of the play. Now here's your 2-on-1, and because of that and how it's forcing the running back to get wider and slow it down the process, I think Amani's got a little bit more time to react to this. He sees it. Now he can jump outside, and he has to make that tackle, and this time he does as they take Elliott out of the play there. There he makes the play. So that one, I give some credit to Hutchinson, I think, and the way that he ended up playing that offensive lineman, taking him out of the play, was, I think, huge. And again, it kind of made this play force a little bit more outside, and now there you are with Imani. Here's another way Lions try to get interesting and do something different. I think we took a look at the beginning of the game, right? The Lions kind of slanting and breaking everybody inside. So let's take a look on this play. That's exactly what they do. They slant their defensive line inside gaps. So Austin Bryant's going to jump to the B. Brocker's to the A. You know, they're all going to kind of slant across. Now, I would think on that, it puts emphasis on Malcolm Rodriguez. But because they're slanting outside, now the linebacker can kind of veer back outside, and he's got to be the contained player on this play. You can see Imani's going to be, you know, dealing with the receiver here. Again, you would like to see him not being, you know, blocked like this, where he's able to actually help us a little bit more than he does. Help us a little bit more on that play. that would be better. But regardless, let's take a look at the linebackers on this play. I think he got tangled up there with his headphones. Let's take a look at this. All right, so another tight alignment for them, but you can see how the Lions crash everybody inside. Now, Malcolm, to me, has to get outside to force this back inside to Alex Anzalone, who's going to be filling in. He can't get picked up by this tight end immediately and just have no one there to slow him down because Alex isn't going to be able to get over there in time. But I think what's a big issue with this one is actually, the crashing almost looked like it worked against the Lions right there. And it looks like the tight end, he's actually going to hit the offensive tackle on this play. He kind of hesitates. He sees Austin Bryan. He's like, okay, I was going to help there. Now he's like, I got to work to the second level. Well, what that does is Malcolm ends up pausing on this play. You see how he stops? Malcolm stops on this play. Now when he goes into the tight end, who blocks well again, there's no shot for Alex to get over there because he's kind of going into him and they're not getting out there fast enough. This should have been, I think, an opportunity where you're seeing something different. You're crashing the defensive lineman. This probably should have been an opportunity where Malcolm can get out there. He can get out on this play right here, right? Go now. You really just go, right? You see the blocking scheme. You got to go. They're crashing inside their gaps. You got to get outside here on the C. And he ends up like hesitating. He ends up pausing with this tight end, getting picked up by the tight end. Now there's no one out here and Amani's getting blocked. This was, again, what the Lions started to try to do a little bit. You have to kind of anticipate a little bit in certain times when you're going to get some runs. So they bring, as we saw, Juju Hughes down. And watch Juju Hughes on his play. He's going to blitz. So how are the Lions going to handle that? Well, he blitz the corner. They're going to have to crash inside. And Thielen's going to try to pick him up. You can see how everybody's crashing like we saw earlier. But he ends up avoiding Thielen, playing through that, and making the play in the backfield. I think that's a good job done by Juju Hughes on this play, but it all stems off of what the entire defensive line is doing by all jumping inside a gap to open up him taking this outside lane. They all have to jump one, so now here comes Juju Hughes inside, and he's able to make this play. Okuda does a great job. I think he's shown, at least in this game, he did a great job of using the sideline, playing inside, right? When they try to release vertically outside, playing the sideline, just getting in the hip. I mean, this is a good game. Watch him here on the top. He's not on Jefferson on this play, but let's take a look. And now that's interesting. You can see that it looks like Justin Jefferson's on Will Harris. So what the Lions felt like they could do is we could put Will Harris in the game, and now we don't have to always match Jeff Okuda with Justin Jefferson and shadow him everywhere. And I think what's a big part of that, if I remember in the past, I didn't like Jeff Okuda when he played in the slot. I thought it gave him some issues. And the Lions have been throwing a lot of help at Jeff Okuda, but Will Harris has played in the slot. He has some experience there, so maybe that's part of the reason.
Also, another part of the reason is probably run defense. I mean, you don't have Tracy Walker, so you have a small Juju Hughes. You have Mike Hughes and Juju Hughes both in the field. You're not getting much size. So putting Will out there, who can act as a corner and basically be like a third safety that's playing some slot, gives you a little bit more size against a run than before, so you can do potentially some of the things that you want to do. As much as I like the way Juju tackles, the Lions really won't put Juju in man situations. So I think that's probably some of the reason.
Watch Jeff Okuda first on this play. You're going to see his feet off the line of scrimmage. You love to see that, right? Moving. Then he gets some contact. Okay, kind of slowing off this route, getting himself back in position. But watch how he doesn't get called for a flag here. He gets in the hip. There's some contact. Puts his hands up like, I'm not grabbing, at the top of the route. He kind of senses it coming. And he's so like latched on here that as receiver changes his movements and tries to break down, he's just giving zero airspace on the top. Look, there's no airspace. He is giving no airspace on this route where there's no change of pace. He's throwing him off. He's using his press. He's being physical. He's challenging, which is one of his best attributes, is being physical at the line, throwing off the timing of the route so it's not crisp, and he's just breaking and making cuts where Okuda's got to respond to everything. He is dictating this coverage to me. He's dictating this route. He's dictating the pacing of this route by the aggressiveness that Jeff Okuda is playing with. All right, let's take a look from the release right here. Okay, boom, false step. You can see it with the little step, and then he's going to dictate right here. Boom. Oh, man, I love it. I love it. Opens up, and then he puts his hands up. He can feel he's starting to come into a break, and he just sits right basically in front of where the break is going to be to the inside. Just sits right in front of the inside break with his hands up. Nowhere to go with the football. I'm forcing you to the sideline. Gives up a whip route here on this play. You can see this is giving him issues in the past, though, quick routes like this. It's tough for a cornerback. It really is. So I get it, and he's trying to make that connection. Usually they try to, like, get the jab. That way they can recover. This play, he doesn't really get that great connection. Thielen kind of plays through it. A little bit off balance trying to get back in position, and he ends up creating a lot of space. You can see you kind of get like a speed release, a little stab, but more of a speed release here from Adam Thielen. And now he's trailing, and I think he's just playing a little bit out of control, playing a little bit over his toes, and there he can't make that recovery and open back up in time.
Monty is not small. He doesn't have a low center of gravity, so when he shows a drag like this and now he's trailing off the release, it's going to be hard for him to put on the brakes and break back open. That's where Okuda's special because of his size, that he's able to do things like that. But Jacobs could do this pretty well because of his build. Monty has other strengths in other areas, though. It's just, again, he has some limitations in man, which we know of.
And they end up picking up the completion. I love the tackle here, though. I do. I absolutely love that. Sorry, not PI. They call it like illegal contact or something. Is that what they called? What they call on this play? Actually, now I'm getting frustrated. Oh, defensive holding. Okay, I'm not sure how this is defensive. I don't know. Either way, he's within 5 yards. I can tell you that. He's within 5 yards. Kuda playing the outside. There's your stab inside. Look at this. He's not running a real route. Like, but I like this because Okuda's playing with confidence. He's playing that cocky game, man. He feels like he's all over Justin Jefferson. Like, bro, you got nothing for me, dude. You got nothing for me. There's the jam. I'm all over this. I'm on top of your route. He's literally in front of him. Where are you going, Jefferson? Bro, I'm on top of your route, and I'm going to throw you to the ground. Probably didn't need to do that, but I'm actually not mad at it. I'm really not. He's within 5 yards, being physical. He's feeling himself. He threw him on the ground. All right, we can. I can do with that, man. Okuda's playing confident right there. And he's playing confident right there, man. My goodness, Hefe, he wasn't playing around. My man threw him on the ground. That's tough. That's tough. Ooh, and yeah. Yeah. Awesome, bro. That's so cool. Oh, gosh. There's a quick set you can see they put on Charles Harris. Hutchinson. Where's Hutchinson? Hutchinson's on the inside. He's been blocked by like three dudes. But you got to win on the edge, man. We had Anthony Pittman trying to win on the edge that time. And Anthony Pittman, I thought, did well. And he actually has been signed to the active roster. I thought Pittman did well winning, specifically in the first preseason game. But after that, I thought he struggled. Here, you kind of want to see him win on that play. But get a little pressure because of, I think, some good coverage and also the flag. You come back, you get another flag. Okay, here we go. We get another flag. And this one's on Amani. So I guess it makes it look worse than maybe it is. But yeah, he's getting called by another flag. You see how he just grabs at the top of the route here. That's where he was having struggles, man. He kept grabbing at the top of the route. Let's take a look at him on this play. Let's take a look. Okay, opens him up. Now he's on the hip. He starts to lean back into Amani, so Amani kind of grabs there. But I think what's tough is now how he's grabbing early, and he's still leaning that way. So now Amani's going to get caught behind him like he was earlier. Now he can't really let go, and now he's just holding on throughout this break. Better than a PI. He doesn't like it. I mean, he does not like that he gave up this. Can we see it from this angle? It's tough because, you know, Jerry Jacob did a great job last year against Elon, and maybe he was trying to do that, playing physical and not being called for flags. They were getting Amani for those. Again, I mean, that one wasn't that – he wasn't grabbing him that much. He was grabbing a little bit. So I can kind of see his frustration with this one. Like, come on, man. This is not a – but he is grabbing, I think, a little more than he needs to. And plus, he's already been called for it multiple times, so he – kind of had that coming, I guess. Who can play? I feel like he's got limitations, but he can play and he's smart. And you know, we'll take a look at the last play where he had like a breakdown. But even this, you know, the jet motion to get out there and make this play in open field is well done to limit that to a 3 yard gain. This, I think, stemmed from Okuda. And again, we're putting a lot of safety help to Okuda's side. This time he's kind of just burnt deep. You could see, you know, immediately jumps off the line. Okuda's not, doesn't look really prepared for that. He gets himself trailing early and now he's got no shot. So he needs a safety help. So that means Amani then is on an island. I think that's part of what he was kind of talking about in his presser. I thought Jacobs did pretty well on an island against Thielen last time, but he is on an island here with really not much help, and he's trying to be physical with him. Again, I don't think this one's too bad, but it's really that top of the route there where he ends up breaking, and then he ends up like kind of grabbing onto him, and he ends up catching this pass late in the play. And I think they did a lot of good trying to slow down our pass rushers like a good team should. You know, they're going to chip Charles Harris. You're going to, well, potentially chip him. And you have this tight end come around. You get some pressure. You would like to see more pressure there from Charles on the tight end. I said coming to this one, I think Charles had to win his one-on-one matchups because they're going to be prepared for Hutchinson, just like Washington started chipping him and trying to take him out of the game. He's going to put emphasis that, Charles, you got to win when you got opportunities. And like some of these, I just don't think he won enough. This was a good recovery by Amani. This is the play, actually, thing I got. I think this is the one that got us off the field by Amani. He gets opened up a little bit here, so let's watch him. There he is. He just seems like he's stumbling, like he's finding himself chasing too quickly. But using that contact, opening up his hips, and recovering on this play was well done, and end up being an incomplete pass. I think that's really good because that one looked like it had a big play written all over it. And we just saw the play before, like Okuda's utilizing that safety help. So there is one deep safety, but this is big time, kind of playing on an island like this to recover, get back in position, and not be burned over top. This first one is actually going to be a incomplete pass, actually, that we're going to take a look at. You can see Okuda's from the slot, again, utilizing his help like we saw earlier. He's got Elliott kind of bracketing him in, so he's sitting on the outside. That's how he was able to kind of utilize that help. Will Harris is also in as an extra defensive back here, so now this time they put him on a tight end. But Amani being physical again, having at the top of the route here a little bit, but I think they were kind of battling with each other. But also you can see how Okuda's using that help that I think ended up happening on this play. So to me, I think what ended up happening is that Juju Hughes was playing the wrong help versus Okuda's leverage. So Okuda's playing inside leverage, utilizing, I think, that outside, well, not the outside, but yeah, the sideline to his help. However, you can see Juju Hughes is starting to slide down. I think he's prepared to help potentially like a crosser for a guy like, you know, Jeff Okuda on this play. But Okuda's playing inside leverage, so he doesn't need to help there. Also, your cornerbacks, you can see on his side of the field, are not playing that kind of leverage, really, where he needs to be helping, I don't think, towards the inside. So on this play, he's in the inside. Okuda's taking his guy towards the sideline. And then when Mike Hughes gets kind of turned around, you can see that there's no one to help over top. So this could have been that, hey, Mike Hughes, you don't have his help. He's playing kind of this more robber type of role. You have to know that. Or it could have been the flip side of, like, Hughes, you're playing the wrong role. You need to be playing too deep here and helping out our guys on this side because you're not really helping anybody crossing the field. And there he just runs right past him, basically. Mike Hughes was still beat on the play. I mean, that happened. It definitely happened. But clearly he was expecting to have some sort of help over top. And you could see that he's playing a little bit almost to the inside. And when he opens up, there's no safety help. And he's like, dude, where is he at? He looks back at Juju. So that's, to me, what ended up happening on that play. But this was the Lions defense, man. There was actually some good in there. It wasn't all terrible. Obviously, we got to get more pressure, but we have to be better on first down. We have to be better at stopping the run. We have to be able to contain, and you got to be prepared against Seattle because they're going to look to run the football. I mean, with Penny, I don't know if Kenneth Walker's healthy, but I know Penny is there. So that's, I mean, it's going to be huge. Stop the run against this team. They put up 50 on us last year, so you can't take them lightly. And yeah, there was some good, was some bad. We'll probably dive back into this, take a look at some of the offensive stuff. But until then, thank you for watching. I'm out.